my life, Charlotte Bronte. What would it be like to shed our old skin like a snake when it grew too small? Perhaps the discomfort we feel at each new stage of growth is something like that feeling. Truly, each new page or stage of life has a difficult introduction. But if we can only remember that, it may help us through the bad times. Too often in the grip of change, we lose sight of what we are becoming. Did you ever wonder how it would feel to be a grub and then turn into a winged creature? It helps us to endure the depressing passage if we can remember that we're being prepared for a new stage of our lives, one in which perhaps we will leave our old selves as far behind as the dragonfly leaves the larva. With time and wisdom comes the knowledge that some pain always accompanies growth. We can accept the pain more gracefully if we remind ourselves that we are preparing to turn a new page. Affirmation. My spirit, like my body, holds the secret of growth and change.
Fatherly and motherly hearts often beat warm and wise in the breasts of bachelor uncles and maiden aunts. And it is my private opinion that these worthy creatures are a beautiful provision of nature for the cherishing of other people's children. Louisa May Alcott. Nature has beautifully provided that all humans can love all other humans. We don't have to be related by blood, nationality, or even language. Unlike the great apes, we have no unbreakable patterns of rivalry and aggression. We are free to choose love as our means of relating. Many people choose a sort of great ape mentality. The choice of mistrust, rivalry, and aggression sometimes threatens to imprison us all in a zoo, surrounded by fences and patrolled by guards. The choice is ours. Can we leave the apes behind? Human love looks risky from a cage. Let's dare to be human today. Affirmation. I can choose to bestow my gift of love.
Grief can take care of itself. But to get the full value of joy, you must have somebody to divide it. Mark Twain. We share this planet that supports us. We share it with other living creatures, each one offering a necessary ingredient that nurtures and sustains the continuation of the whole. Every experience that involves one of us involves others who also need what the experience may teach. We're not alone, ever. We are traveling a path in concert with others whose needs are similar to our own. We can expect to discover joyous occasions and will undoubtedly be visited by grief in our travels. The latter will be eased by the knowledge that others too have known grief. Joy, on the other hand, is doubled in intensity when we acknowledge the occasion, giving birth to it, and then celebrate it with others. No day passes without giving us many occasions to shout for joy. Too often, feeling alone and lonely, we close our eyes to the wonders that could excite us. The most fruitful lesson we can learn is that we have fellow travelers among whom joy abounds and multiplies when shared. Affirmation. Today, I'll look for the joy in my life.
If you would be loved, love and be lovable. Benjamin Franklin. We all desire to be loved. Our common human characteristic is our need to count in someone else's life. At least one other person needs us, we tell ourselves, when we feel least able to accept life's demands. How alike we all are. The paradox is that our own need for love is lessened when we bestow it on others. Give it away, and it returns, a promise one can trust. The reality about love, an its path from sender to receiver and back again is often distant from our minds. More often we stew and become obsessed with the lack of love's evidence in our lives. Why isn't he smiling? Why didn't she care? Has someone more interesting taken our place? Choosing to offer love rather than look for it will influence every experience we have. Life will feel gentler, and the rewards will be many and far-reaching. Affirmation. Loving others promises me the love I desire, but I can't expect it if I don't give it first.
To be what we are and to become what we are capable of becoming is the only end in life. Robert Louis Stevenson. Our creation was our invitation to contribute that which is uniquely our own to the life process. Our brothers and sisters have been likewise invited. Our experiences are not without purpose. They offer us opportunities to practice the contributions that we have been created to make. Realizing potential is possible when we are committed to stepping forward to meet the challenges head on. No challenge is beyond our capability. Every challenge promises new growth and a measure of serenity. Our search for security, for self-worth, if it's sincere, pledges us to stay with the daily challenges. They will teach us all that we are prepared to learn. Affirmation. I go forth today with anticipation and gratitude for the opportunity to be wholly one. My experiences will be exactly what I'm ready for.
Bloody faces, muddy shoes, blood. 100 years hence. Dear Cecil,
in Rome, but the wind was so great that she had to go home. Ah! I couldn't have liked it more. I have been to a marvelous party. We didn't stop dinner till 10, and young Bobby Carr did a start at the bar with a lot of extraordinary men. Dear Mama, I was a turtle which shattered us all to the core. But the Grand Duke was boring the hell out of me when suddenly Cyril cried, "Fiddle-dee-dee!" Ripped off his trousers and jumped in the sea. I couldn't have liked it more. From her fisherman's vest that her bust had been whittled away. Poor Lulu got fried on Chianti and talked about esprit de corps. Maurice made a couple of passes at Gus, but Billy, who hates any kind of a pass, did hop the big apple and twisted his truss. I couldn't have liked it more. God, we talked about growing old gracefully, and Elise, who's 74, said, "Nay, it's a question of being sincere, and me, if you're supple, you have nothing to fear." Then she swung upside down from a glass chandelier. I couldn't have liked it more. It was the most divine party of it.
I have, but Billy Gordon's breakfast bag.
Ask yourself what you
could be done.
Hey, why did you give Billy a stick of gum?
That's creative. That's smart.
Hey, at least he didn't fart.
That's all. You're rapping like we're 10 feet tall. Since you're such an Eagle Scout, tell us what it's all about.
C-F-M.
It's about caring, about sharing, about walking through fears and smiling through tears. It's family, friends, and faith from above. Make the right choices, live in love. Do you hear me?
Yeah!
Are you out there?
Yeah!
Everybody say live!
Live!
take something from yourself to give to another. That is humane and gentle, and never takes away as much comfort as it brings again. Thomas More. We take different kinds of pleasure in giving. Perhaps the purest is the gift to a child so young, it doesn't really know where the gift came from. The pure joy that the teddy bear or the pool toy produces is our reward, unmixed by any expectation of return. When children get older, we want something in return. Gratitude, respect. The gift is less pure. When lovers exchange gifts, the pleasure is often tinged with anxiety. Did I give more than I got? Did I get more than I gave? Or with power? He'll always remember where he got that shirt. Or she owes me something for that fur jacket. To friends and relations, our gifts reflect many things. Our appreciation of their lives, our shared memories, our prosperity. We tend to give in the spirit of self-expression. Perhaps the closest we can come to a pure gift is an anonymous one, a gift of volunteer work, donation of blood, contribution to a charity. Such a gift, which can never be acknowledged or returned by those it comforts, can heal our spirits when they are wearied by too much ego. Affirmation. The gift of myself can be a gift to myself.
I was numb when I walked into the test site. What the hell was I doing? Why was I here? Why find out? It was 1986, and there was no medical support for people infected with AIDS virus. No drugs like ACT, no recommended therapies, nothing except the grim reality. But here I was. After sitting through a depressing video telling me of the seriousness of the disease, not exactly news, I talked to a counselor. Did I really understand the test? What it means to be HIV positive? Yes. All too well. Friends had started dying. I saw men with Kaposi sarcoma and men walking with canes in the cafes and stores of the Castro where I had been living for several years. I knew, all right. They drew a vial of my blood and sent me away in 2 weeks for the results. Now, I had it all figured out. I assumed I was positive. After all, I had moved to the castle to be part of the big celebration. I figured 6 years of gay civil rights struggles earned me the right to enjoy our newly won freedoms. At least we could be gay in the sunlight. Terrific. After all the marches and lobbying, we had won the right to be ourselves in 3 neighborhoods. Greenwich Village, West Hollywood, and the Castro. 3 places where we could feel safe to be ourselves. Safe, that is, if you didn't count the thugs who came into the neighborhood to do a little friendly fag bashing. So what? I took self-defense class, I carried mace, and counted myself among the fortunate few who could actually live in the heart of the Castro. Sure, of course I thought I gotta be infected. I mean, I played, and loved and celebrated gay liberation. I've been using condoms for a year or so, but it might have been too late by the time I started. So, I thought I was prepared for the worst. I was wrong. When I went back to the test site, to the counselor, 2 weeks later, she opened the envelope and told me my results. You are infected with HIV. Your blood shows antibodies to the AIDS virus. I was stunned. I started to shake all over. I found myself standing in the middle of the room crying and trembling. She was talking, but I couldn't hear a thing. A huge noise was like a wind tunnel was rushing past my ears. It wasn't going to be like this. I was prepared. I thought I knew. I thought I could handle it better. I was angry and frightened. Shocked. When I left the test site, all the Victorian houses started closing in on me. The city was oppressive. I couldn't breathe. I knew some quiet place in my heart that I was in shock. Somehow I kept walking. I got into my car and started to drive out of the city, past the houses of friends. I wanted desperately to stop and tell them, but I was afraid. Afraid of people who loved me. Afraid of giving them this burden. I just drove it and drove it. I crossed the bridge and headed north on the coast highway past Stinson Beach to Point Reyes. I found a solitary place and walked and cried and ran and sat on the rock and watched the sunset. Later, cold and calm, I returned to San Francisco. It would never be the same. It took me a long time to tell my friends. Now, of course, they all know. They're working through their grief as I have. The family, well, they took longer to tell. Oh, but they've been great. Mom. She reads everything she can about AIDS. She clips out newspaper articles about new treatments. And since that first shock, I've learned that I've been HIV positive for a long time. See, I'm in a study. There are several hundred men in the group. All of us participated in a hepatitis study in the 70s. And the researchers, well, they saved our blood, so they checked and discovered that I was already infected in 1979. That's almost 12 years. Well, I'm doing well. It feels like a miracle. But they tell us that 79% of the guys in the study who were infected before 1980, that's AIDS or ARC, or they've already died. Why am I here? What am I doing with this gift of life? I know. I really know. And that's the best part about this. My life has more value and meaning than ever before. So really, though it may seem strange, but HIV has been an amazing gift. I've learned many lessons about loving and forgiving and about celebrating life. And I'm still here.
volunteer work back in Chicago that had never done it, so I took down the number. After 4 days of intense training, I was ready to be matched with the client. Or was I? I didn't have a lot of time to think about it because a week later I got the call. Looking back, I know that I pictured myself with a young, gay, white man whom I would immediately connect with. So much for that idea. My new client was 40 years old, a straight man, a Puerto Rican, and he had a 20-year history with heroin use. What? Oh, God! Okay, take a deep breath. I met him a few days later at the county hospital. The stark concrete walls and chaotic waiting area shook me out of my white middle-class days. This wasn't like any hospital I've ever seen before. Fighting back excruciating pangs of nervousness, I found Ward B and my new buddy. He shook my hand and smiled. Our conversation was awkward, especially because I understood very little of what he was saying. Help! And yet, from that moment on, he was no longer a heroin addict. He was a very lonely, sick, and horribly thin person. I kept on visiting, and he talked. He loved to talk. I quickly learned to understand his mix of Spanish and English, and little by little I began to unweave the threads of life so complicated and yet so wonderfully simple. He talked about his family and his intense devotion to his mother, how he got involved in drugs at the age of 14, his 7 years in the Puerto Rican prison system, and how he worked construction and liked creating things with his hands. I fought back tears as he told me about his loneliness and isolation. His friends didn't understand it, and one by one they drifted away. It never seemed like I did anything for him in a practical sense, but it was clear that my visits made a difference. They had an effect on him. I remember how his face would light up when I poked my head into the hospital room. Over the course of an hour or two, he would change from a depressed, lethargic patient into Chicharito, a crazy, vibrant, laughing man filled with energy. He'd gone 30 pounds in that time. He moved home with his sister and her family, and his health problems became less a focus. But other problems came before. I found myself overwhelmed with a whole lifetime of social problems, most of which stem from the lure of drugs and the difficulty of breaking the cycle of addiction. Still, we laughed a lot, and I spent many hours talking with him, sitting on the couch or the bench outside in front, talking to my friend. On October 3rd, 1990, I called for him as usual, but this time I got his son who said, "My dad's not here. He was killed last night. You better come right over." I was in shock. What? I had just seen him a couple of days ago. His body had been found outside an apartment building in Richmond. He'd been beaten to death. The police called it a drug-related murder. The shock eventually wore off, and then pain and a terrible emptiness took its place. I didn't get to say goodbye. This isn't how it was supposed to end. You see, he had lived a very vital life, and he had died that way too. But the man that I remember was soft and loving and full of laughter. And never forget it. My life will never be quite the same.
I'm not a day goes by.
Sharing sodas, sharing secrets, sharing makeup. now chorus boys are. They like to stay pretty, and I appreciate that at my age, so. Yes, it's lovely here. I love rainbow suspenders, too. Anybody else? Love them. I love the leg warmers. I love the old 70s dance look. It just brings back all these fabulous memories. Anybody remember the 70s? Yeah? Anybody fantasize about them like I do? I loved the 70s. I loved Farrah Fawcett. Anybody remember Farrah? Everybody loved her, remember? I mean, did everybody comb their hair like hers, or am I dreaming? Remember feathered hair? Wings, as we called it. I loved Charlie's Angels. Love that show. Anybody remember the show? You remember the show, but you don't remember any certain plot of any show. I don't even remember a subplot. All I remember, really, is Farrah doing this. Reeves. Like a piece. I love the 70s. I mean, who could turn the world on with a smile? I ask you. They got a laugh out of her, and that's all I care about. So, oh, I gotta make one thing clear before I go on. I've heard all the dirty rumors and gossip backstage. I think it's time I put an end to that. Don't you agree? I mean, I can't believe it's followed me all the way from San Francisco across the bridge to here. I mean, really, I think it's time I put an end to it. I'm gonna make one statement, and one statement only, and then I really don't want the subject raised again. Are you with me, everybody? Okay, listen up now, really. And I quote, Joe Montana and I are just friends. I don't want to talk about it again, please. Please, no, please. Hands at your laps. No. I mean, sure, we work together. Joe and I did a little TV commercial for LA Gear. You guys know what LA Gear is? It's, yeah, it's that white trash clothing people in Los Angeles wear. And what can they do? How can they help it? It's those tube tops, halter tops, you know, hot pants. All that stuff. And Joe is the LA Gear spokesperson. In the commercial, he played himself quite well. And I played a nerd. Can you imagine? What a stretch. Flat pants, striped shirt, black horn rims, the whole attire. There I was on the set. Lights, camera, action. Get the picture. And the producer came up from behind me and said, excuse me, Scott, this is Joe. I turned, and Joe Montana was standing right there. I mean, what do you all think of Joe? You know, people say that all the time. I just don't see it. So, anyway, the producer said to me, Scott, this is what we need from you. We need you to look at Joe deeply, intently. Look deep into his eyes. Press your face up against his. Then peruse his body, down his torso, past his legs, till you see his shoes. You're stunned at the gloriousness of his shoes. TV, stupid. So you peruse back up his legs, past his waist, without a pause. Until you get back to his face, where you say, nice shoes. Now, Scott, can you do that? I said, yes, I can do it. I'd love to do it. Let the good times roll. So the camera started to roll. I turned. Joe was standing this close. All I could think was, I'm going to bite your lips. But I thought that would be career suicide, so I didn't try. Wise choice. So I looked deeply, intently into those light blue eyes. Then I went down his body, past his legs, till I saw his shoes, and they are so big. You know what I'm saying? So. placed without a pause, and that really killed me. Until I got back to his face, where I said, nice, shoes. Joe, can we try that again? Makeup! So, we shot that scene again and again and again. We kept shooting and shooting and shooting all day. Joe and I just shot. And, we were both exhausted, of course. Both needed a cigarette. So, Joe invited me back to his trailer. You know, first cigarette, couple of beers. You know how men are, you know. But nothing happened in that trailer. I'm really offended. We are close friends. Sure, a little male bonding occurred. And that threatens people, but that's all. There were no, as I've heard, quarterback squats going on. No man-to-man contact. I see the confusion, though. I mean, there we were, two attractive men, me being one of them. Alone in a trailer, you know how men are, straight or gay, two drinks, they'll suck anything. But no! That's Joe on top. The way I prefer it. Stay with me. So Monday, I have to audition for a U.S. Army training film. I mean, I'm a queen. Did I mention that? What is the Army gonna do with me? Put me in front of the camera, have me say something like, boys, you've gotta join the Army, it's fabulous. Maybe it'll be one of those do's and don'ts films, you know, what to do, what not to do in the US Army. I'll be in the don't section. Don't have sex with your sergeant, they'll have me like, on some big guy fatigues with a big red X across it. You all want to be me, don't you? You see me, you think limo, limo, limo. You see me, you think glamour. Sequins, gowns. You see me, you think an Academy Award is in my future. You see me, you think Emmys, Tonys. You see me, you think Johnny Carson, Geraldo. You see me, you see a future Hollywood Square, and it's true. But I have no love, no time, I'm too busy. No time for, I guess sex is what I'm talking about. I didn't mean to be rude, but I think the last time I had an orgasm, I was wearing a mood ring. I mean, I've tried dating, but it's too scary, these blind date things. You guys do that? It's too scary. My friends always think they know what's best for me, you know? They're always like, oh, Scott, we've met someone and he's perfect for you. He's perfect for you. He is so much like you. Then I go up to these guys and I think, what do my friends really think about me? I'd rather stay home and watch television with my cat. Hey, what's going on with cats and flies? Anybody understand that relationship between cats and flies? I have a cat. I mean, I look at a fly, I go, oh, a fly. You know, perhaps you look at a fly, you think, oh, a fly. My cat looks at a fly, and my cat goes... totally paralyzed in fear. Flies are this big, cats are huge, apparently. What could that fly be doing? And it's like floating above my cat, telling it little cataphobic jokes. Anyway, I watched lots of TV with my cats. And I watched this show a few weeks ago. Anybody see it on Channel 4 called Growing Up and Coming Out? Anybody see that? That is what I thought. Where a woman, Ms. Sullivan, she's a newscaster on Channel 4. She went into the homes of, like, middle-class Bay Area homes and interviewed kids who had come out of the closet to their parents, which I think is very brave, you know? And their parents were interviewed, everyone was interviewed, everyone was so hip and relaxed about their kids coming out. 16-year-old kids were so cool and laid back and mellow about their sexuality. How nice for them. Can you imagine coming out when you're 16? I was still wearing braces when I was 16. Don't laugh, I was wearing headgear. Anybody wear that stuff? That big crowbar went across your face? Down your back? Mine tied around my ankles, came up and tied a big bow across my neck. Felt like I was being punished. I waited until I was 18 and beautiful to come out, as I am now. These kids kept saying, too, that when they told their parents they were gay, that their parents were so shocked. Everyone was so surprised. So shocked and surprised. How nice for them. What did I do wrong? When I came out to my family, everybody said the same thing. No, we already knew. I told my father I was gay. He said, I already knew that. At least you're not knocking up any chicks. He's so sensitive. I told my mother I was gay. She said, oh, honey. Duh. I'm like, how did you guys know? I didn't know. They're like, oh, we don't know. We just knew. Right? Yep. We knew. Of course they knew, though. When I was a kid, I was a total mini queen. You know the time. Total queer in waiting. Total. Total FOMO. A little fag just waiting to happen. I used to dry clean my backpack. I Windexed my locker like twice a week. I had every color corduroy of the rainbow. And I used to wash my corduroy inside out and then iron it while it was wet so I didn't flatten out my blue corduroy. I had a diary. Oh, diary! Bag alert! Diary! In it, I recorded each outfit I wore each day so I didn't repeat the same outfit the same month. I know some of you did that. I had a wooden hanger installed in my gym locker, and I told my gym instructor, look, I'll take the course, but I will not perspire. Model UN, Mathletes, French Club, I took the drama club way too seriously. I had to. I was a little queen. I'm a big one now. I used to rush home at 3 to see Dinah. Remember that show? Dinah. Such a queen show. Fabulous guests, Charles Nelson Reilly. Wicker furniture, shake, haircuts, shake, carpeting, shake, check, 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 check. I loved it. Of course they all knew, they always know. It's threatening my masculinity a little bit, but they always know. Just once, I'd like to tell someone I was gay and have them say, no way. Together, the growing up and coming out show, she and I had a little parent-son bonding. And she had questions for me about sexuality, of course. But she's Catholic, so she asked all the questions in a whisper. And she, her first question was, of course, honey, tell me. What do lesbians do in bed? But if you want to know, ask your neighbor, Miss Schmidt. Miss Schmidt is a lesbian. Mother, figure it out. Plaid jacket. Big dog. Bigger keys. Bigger motorcycle. Put it together. She said, oh, honey, I know all those things. I just thought she was German.
Hey,
You guys have been fabulous. Have a nice rest of the evening.
Pacific Bell.
watching us. Watching us. Watching us. God is watching us. He is watching us. He is watching us. From a distance, the world looks blue and green, and the snow-capped mountains white. From a distance, the ocean meets the stream, and the eagle takes to flight.
Distance.
often feel alone with our struggles. And it's true that each of us must come to our own terms with whatever situation faces us. But no struggle facing us is free from the influence of other people and their struggles. We have a shared destiny. Knowing that we share this journey offers comfort when we need it in our daily struggles. We are not alone, forgotten, unimportant to the destiny of others, nor are others without meaning in the experiences we're gifted with. Our existences are mutual. We are interdependent contributors to the total life cycle. What each of us learns eases the struggles of another. All experiences are meant for the good of us all. Affirmation. Today I may feel alone, but I'm not. My life is in full concert with those around me. All as it should be. If you listen carefully, you get to hear everything you didn't want to hear in the first place. Sholem Aleichem. What are those things we don't want to hear? Mainly, we don't want to hear disagreement from people who are important to us. We don't want to hear that our children are making choices that we wouldn't make. We don't want to hear that our partner thinks us anything but perfect. We don't want to hear that our friend, our parent, our teacher, our boss sees anything in us to criticize. Poor us. We know we aren't perfect, but we can't tolerate hearing it from anybody else. Why should that be? We know other people aren't perfect either. Where did we get this idea that we're supposed to be error-free? To accept our own imperfection is to make a giant step toward peace of mind. To accept that the world is full of people who disagree with us, many of whom even love us very much, is to begin to achieve maturity. Perhaps we think, or used to think, that we would be happy when we rubbed out our last traces of imperfection, but that's not happiness. That's becoming marble, hard, cold, and breakable. Affirmation. True spiritual progress begins with my acceptance of my imperfections.
The cruelest lies are often told in silence. Robert Louis Stevenson. Is it frequent that we fail to come forth to explain, defend, or offer support? Remaining silence is always our option, no matter how grave the situation. Holding back information that would ease another's pain or shed light on a hateful experience is cruel. The effects of cruel acts will find their way back to the actor. The axiom, as we sow, so shall we reap, is true. Perhaps we need reminding that our performance is unique and essential to those around us. Together we move forward in concert. When any of us falters or misses a cue, another one of us is likely to miss one too. We are alive to honor one another's presence, and only when we are fully present, honest, and straightforward, are we fulfilling our role? Affirmation. Today I share center stage. Let me speak my lines fully.
The mind is a baby giant. Who more prominent in his cradle than he knows, has hurled his paths in life all round ahead of him, like playthings. Robert Frost. Sometimes we are bewildered by the options open to us. We feel we have no way of knowing which course would be best. But when we reflect calmly on our choices, we usually find very few that are realistic, that are in tune with our personalities, and constant with the rest of our lives. It sometimes seems that a choice made or an option dropped when we are very young can determine our whole lives. This is probably an illusion. Perhaps we believe that our fate was forever altered by missing a train 10 years ago. Late at night, we might talk wistfully of what might have been. If only I'd caught that train! Most likely, though, our lives would have turned out just about the same. What happens to us and what we choose seem to follow the same pattern, a pattern that is true for each one of us. We've marked out our paths, whether we're fully aware of them or not. Affirmation. Sometimes I am indecisive because I desire to remain open to life's choices. Today, I will act freely and strengthen that freedom by making responsible decisions.
Courage is fear that has said its prayers. Anonymous. No one of us is always courageous. With trepidation, we embark on many journeys. Fear is dispelled each time we rely on our inner strength and trust that our lives are in good hands. Self-talk is powerful and will prepare us to meet whatever lies ahead today. Self-talk is like prayer and quiets our fears, making it possible to give our full attention to the events transpiring. Self-talk is positive, cultivates a healthy self-image, one that offers security even in the face of disaster. We all carry on a dialogue with ourselves much of the time, taking charge of the messages, making sure they enhance our personal well-being is an option open and always available to all of us. No situation is more than we can handle. Whatever courage or strength is needed is as close as our willingness to go within, to commune with ourselves. Affirmation. I must own my fears before I can let them go. Courage follows closely on their departing footsteps.
Thank you. Nice guys.
I'm a very nice guy, see?